most of you have been here for Scar Days. For those who haven't, I'm glad you made it if you came from UK, because apparently a lot of flights have been cancelled. And I've been told that a couple of people are here because their flights back have been cancelled, so... And apparently the Tech-Level Summit seems like a better idea than staying at the airport, so thanks for that. Okay, finally I have some thanks to give out. First and foremost, of course, our speakers, and in particular our keynote speaker, Andrea. Who has invited us to a party with hats.
Yes, okay.
And also all the other speakers, of course. And thanks to our sponsors, which you can find on the website. And also thanks to our two volunteers outside on the registration desk who have been helping to get you all signed up. And I think that's it. So without further ado, please have a warm welcome for Andrea.
Good morning. By the way, I've seen they've signed the books. He really loves autographing the books. So if you ever get a print book, he really, really likes it. So don't forget to do that, right? And also, I realized that as a keynote speaker, I get to tell people what to do somehow. And I'm a very benevolent dictator. So basically, your task should be choose it. And actually, for the speakers, you don't have a choice because I will harass you. You have to draw something on this place because, you know, I was feeling a little bit lonely, so I drew some cards to keep me company. And so the speakers need to draw something, for sure. And everybody else, I mean, you have to do it too, really, but I don't know you personally, but I can hunt the speakers. So. Anyway, thank you very much for inviting me to this party of the conference, right? You know, thank you. I feel I felt like I had a responsibility to do something interesting and fun. So I thought a party with animals. That doesn't look like a party, but that was a good image of a party. It looked good in my machine, so you have to just trust me. And there it just looks like the pigs, sort of like stomach problems. Anyway, so this inviting everyone to the party is about paradigms of programming, right? So disclaimer. Most of these things that I'm going to say here might need a context. So if you feel enraged and want to grab your nearest pitchfork, just remember that I may be talking within some sort of context, and I hope that you can be awake enough to, you know, awake in the sense that you're actually awake because it's really early. You know, just try to keep in context the interruptions, etc., are somewhat welcome, unless I tell you that you're not. Then we can wait until later, because maybe I'm trying to put a whole idea together. So that's important. Another thing ahead. So I come from Ireland. Sometimes we say words like the crack, which is kind of fun, and I say stuff like Egypt. If you're not familiar with those, you know, anyway, you deal with that. So I promised hats, but I got something better. So the hats were because these important protagonists of this talk couldn't come, I thought, but they actually were able to come. Dun, 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 dun. This is Bacon, right? A very, very well-experienced developer squirrel. Right? You're like, what is going on? Okay, Bacon. Bacon is a programmer. Bacon's been programming in Delphi, Pascal, right? Right? Yeah, cool. So it's a basic, did you like it? It's a basic .NET, C#. He knows all the solid concepts, like all the programming patterns. Gang of Four, he had it in his bedside, right? Cool. Okay, so Bacon. You need to respect those years of experience, right? Then at some point, he started learning F# and C#, you know, with C#. And when he was doing C#, he really liked the link concepts, you know, all the stuff in link. Have you used link? Anybody use link? Do you think it's good? Say yes. Yes, good. it's like a very nice introduction to some functional concepts, etc. Then he started to learn Scala. And basically, you know, it's like he was really, really excited about this stuff. Oh my God, reference to transparency, less mutable state. Programming just becomes just so much easier. Your brain is clearer. You can stop thinking, did I forget about that thing that is modified 58 concepts ago or contexts ago? How many books can I remove from all of this? And he was really, really excited, right? And the thing is, like, sometimes when you're very excited, you can do stuff like this. You can say, oh my god, I was programming Java after many times, and that was literally the worst, right? It's good, but some of Bacon's friends felt a little bit bad because, you know, they were like, so, you know, you think you're like so great? So they were like, I don't know about you, you know? So when Bacon, when he talks about functional programming, what's he actually talking about? Bacon is talking about, he's adorable, isn't he? I know. He's talking about type functional programming. So that means we're in the context of either a runtime, which is either the JVM of .NET. Bacon wants to do FP everywhere. Bacon wants to, you know, even when maybe he feels like it's really, really hard to do FP. And he's got this idea that every function, every single function should be either a pure or even better total function. Wouldn't that be cool? Every function is total, so you know exactly everything. The reality is that's quite hard because, you know, sometimes Bacon doesn't know how to make all functions pure because, well, you know, sometimes you have to talk to Java libraries or .NET libraries and they don't care about being pure. They want to side effects all over the place. And maybe he doesn't know some of these concepts, the higher concepts. Then, for example, when you could think, oh, well, one way that we can deal with this complexity is we're going to wrap this library, right, and make it a nice functional wrapper that's idiomatic in whatever version of idiomatic he thinks it is. But that does not scale, does it? I don't think so, anyway. So, what are the problems with FP? But this is like Bacon's FP. It's not yours with B or mine or anything. This is his. Something like dependency management for him is way harder than it should. Because, for example, say you have to use a particular framework. And this is why I'm not showing any code, because I didn't want to start wars. So if you use a framework X to do web development, that framework might tell you, you have to bring your dependencies in this way. If you use a different one, you have to do it this different way. It's like, and Bacon thinks, should this be like, I mean, we all have this problem. We'll have to deal with this stuff. Shouldn't we have this coming from the language? I mean, isn't this a higher enough abstraction that we can create at a language level? Then you have type Tetris. I mean, Tetris is fun. It's like nearly my favorite game, and I was a game developer in a previous life, right? So, you know. You know, sometimes you actually need to get some stuff done, and it's it's like, okay, this thing is just not working, and you kind of start throwing stuff at the compiler until it works. I don't know if this is your experience, but Bacon told me this is a thing. And Dave is nodding, so I'm fine. Then this is a complicated concept, right? And this is something that Kelly actually totally nailed it with this stuff. Did you see this quiz? Did everybody see the quiz?
Yeah.
Did you all do it? Mm-hmm. Who didn't do it? Lift your hand. Okay, all of you, you're totally going to do this quiz, right? It's a quiz that basically has two made-up concepts and one real one, like the weird ones. And you have to choose one. These concepts are complicated, and there's loads of them. And let's say Bacon is really applied, and if he really, really, really tries to do it, he can learn it, but he can't force all his coworkers, right? Is that even fair? So that's one thing. Bacon dreams of well-structured programs, right? John Hughes described what he saw in FP. This is the dream. This is what we want. This is if you haven't read this paper, at least read the intro. It's really inspiring, and the rest is actually quite readable. Why functional programming matters. So John Hughes talks about modularity and trying to, you know, basically create solutions that are, you know, let's say componentized, but modularized is actually the correct name, right? So, where am I going with this? The lovely O! It's an L. I used to call them O's for a long time until someone corrected me, because apparently that's not how you pronounce it in English. How do you do that? Is it? anyway, so ooh, so now, what about you? She works with bacon. She learned to program in Fortran. Some people say she might be coding Grace. There's Grace Hopper, best friend, maybe a twin. Dun, dun, dun. No, not really. Ooh, here. So performance for her is everything. She's like literally knows exactly when you give her a thing, when you give her any, you know, bit of code, she goes in like, oh no, that's not gonna perform right. We all have a friend like that. It's like we all have the friend with regex. Exactly. So anyway, she knows the stuff. It's like she talks with Bacon, and Bacon seems up to be a bit of an extremist according to her, but she's curious because she can see some good stuff. Like, for example, she read this ACM magazine about how functional programming, and it makes parallelism and distribution great, right? This is from the ACM magazine from 2014. This is Oderski himself with Rumpf talking about this stuff, right? That sounds good, right? Can you read this? Yeah, cool. Okay, so pragmatic choices. Well, that sounds right up Ooh's alley, right? Kind of unifying disparate programming language philosophies. And this is like, Ooh is like, okay. And because Ooh has done a lot of FOWL, when Ooh squints, it kind of looks like a little bit of what people talk when we're talking about functional programming. Are these concepts perhaps more orthogonal that we'd like to think about? Then, you know, maybe sometimes we kind of think this is a true blah, blah, blah. But maybe this is like, also, have you ever seen an owl squint? I've never had. So that's the conflict between these two, right? And I had to choose these really cuddly toys that I can travel with to represent this. Because I've seen this fight in within Scala, and I've seen this fight also between C sharp and F sharp. So I kind of thought maybe this is not unique to us. Okay, so let's see the perspective from the creators of these two languages that are somewhat similar, right? So, Don Tsai, the creator, the designer of F#, obviously a lot of people work in the language, says the Scala is about, you can do creation at large. So you can do basically any part of them. But when it comes to F#, the idea is to do a function in the core and object orientation at large. So this is why he's talking about components here. It's like, do you want to make a component to share to everything? This is how you do it. This is in 2009, the link is there, everything I'm quoting, there's references, and I put the slides up if you really want to do it. So that's Don Simon's view. So I think it's important to bring this in because it's like, just at least it's not just our little word. It's like, okay, someone else is agreeing with this. Okay. What does Oderski and Rumpf had to say about this stuff? Scala, pragmatic choices, disparate philosophies. The key lesson is these philosophies need no contradiction in practice. Okay, that's quite cool. And I think we all know this. It's just kind of refreshing to see it. This is their words, no messing. Scala gives programmers the choice. This resonates with what Miles was saying yesterday during the closing panel. And most importantly, choice also gives responsibility to the programmers. So, and this is really cool. The novice Scala programmers need guidance, right? So this is really important. Now, so we see this view from the creators of the languages that these two things should be nicely and harmoniously living together, but the reality is that when Ooh and Bacon talk, there is a very, like, you could feel like they are, you know, chairs could be thrown around, but they have no hands except the squirrel. So, so they sometimes they call each other names. It's not very good. So these two things are at odds. So we find the tension between them. We find the tension between the language creators. There's an art tension, though. Doing and thinking. This is at Alice Church and Mr. Turing's half face. So why I bring these two together is like they actually represent for me something that is very common throughout the programming in general, which is there was a problem. The entire student problem. And these two people came with completely different solutions to the same problem, but actually they were kind of the same solution. So there was some sort of unification, right? So another church came with the lambda calculus and Turing came with the Turing machine. So one of them was more, let's call it, there's no good word I found for this, but one of them is the homebrew, the organic, the pragmatic approach. Let's call it that way, that you can also see in Alan Kay and etc. And for the other side, you have a more analytical, more you know, studied, more, you know, kind of trying to check all the dots approach of Church and or Dijkstra. And you can see this tension. And actually, if you look at how you and your people that you work with work, you will find these two approaches. One of very like, you know, let's just. And there is like, oh, I'm gonna think about it. And then they both produce amazing things. So this is an art tension that is more like in the core of, and you're just who you are. This is how you turn out. So there's this art tension. But in the end, we need to build shit. Sorry, systems. right, and we need this thing. We need languages, we need tools, we need people. Actually, the problem is kind of people, isn't it? Because the compiler doesn't care what you think. It will just kind of compile. I mean, when and the context to this, so when you bring people into the thing, the problem is the context is really important. What you have in your brain when you're making decisions is super important. Because if I say something like FRP, GUIs are just much better with FRP. There's a bunch of stuff I have in my head that I'm not saying. There's like at least a 3,000 word blog post, that why I say that. So if I'm talking to you and you disagree and you don't have that context, and that's your job. It's like, it's really hard to really, you know, make this work. So this is why some people agree and disagree. There's just generally a lack of context. This is what I think. But anyway, so we have this context problem. But what we actually have is a bunch of problems. From Bacon's point of view, he's thinking multi-paradigm. Languages are literally the worst. I want a language that just tells me what to do and why did we do this? And so the question really is, are multi-paradigm programming languages any good? Is functional programming the best? Or object-oriented, insert your preferred paradigm, is it the best? Obviously, you know, let's think. But then also, we know, like we're all alive long enough to know that things change over time. I mean, what, 10 years ago, object-oriented programming was like, oh, the new kid on the block. Or maybe, you know, this is how the industry was moving, right? So these are really elevated questions. It's like, are we even gonna solve this? And the best thing I could do about that is give us a framework to think about this. Because we spend a lot of time fighting about this and thinking about this. So let's think about it in some order way. Peter Van Roy wrote this paper, Programming Paradigms for Dummies, what every programmer should know. And this is his definition of a paradigm. Then I'm going to show off with this. If you can't study this diagram, again, I said the links are in the talk, it's completely rewarding. There's 37 programming paradigms here. So that's totes my goats. And actually, this is a complete study. This is a person that spent quite a bit of time distilling how to categorize this, right? And so you have functional programming, you have lazy concurrent constraint programming. This paper explains how we got to those names. It's not like he just went like, you know what, This is great. I'm going to just come up with random stuff. So someone that studied this stuff came up with these conclusions. So we need these paradigms are like tools. And for given tools, there are better solutions. How many times have you found something when you were, I don't know about you, but for me, a perfect example of this is metaprogramming. When I was younger, when Bacon was younger, when Bacon was younger and he was learning to program, sometimes he found a problem. And someone said, oh, you need to like metaprogram that with reflection and stuff. And I was like, you know nothing, Jon Snow. The thing is, then someone that actually knew better when this is like, listen, you wrote like all this code, super error prone. We can like do some reflection and like some metaprogramming concepts, and this is going to be just much, much better. And this is why you have to maintain and browse code. So yes, it's like learning these little things is like super useful. Hello. So this is why program languages support many paradigms. So this is what Peter is saying. In a well-factored way, without being encumbered by others. So if a language is truly multi-paradigm, it should do this. I am assuming that you're reading, right? Because otherwise I can read out for you. Well, you know. So that's interesting. In fact, in Peter's experience, this is clearly the way normal programming should happen. Okay? And this is a really important thing that he found. Dun, dun, dun. There's no one best paradigm. I think that's a very like strong statement from someone that studied paradigms. Maybe there is one true best paradigm for one given context explicitly, like just that particular problem. Anyway, so I think this gives us some sort of framework to think about paradigms, right? Okay, cool. So what about the changing of the paradigms? So in here, we can come, like, you know, we were talking about like maybe this happened before with the F-sharp. So this is the face you can't see in the back is Thomas Kuhn. And this guy wrote a book called The Structure of Scientific Revolutions. It's a great read. And I think, you know, if you like reading, you should maybe pick it up. The book is about 50 years old, and it talks about how science actually doesn't happen. You know, if you went to school and you learned about this happened more or less at this time, then this happened, and it kind of feels like a linear history. Surprise level, absolute zero. History is not linear. Stuff happened all over the place. Stuff feels like some stuff happened before and after where it felt like it should have happened, which is very strange. It's kind of like Git history, you know? It's a mess. So one thing that he studied in his book is how these changes actually happen. So this proliferation of compelling articulations, basically, when you're kind of willing to give up that thing that you think is the core of what you believe in as a scientist slash engineer slash programmer, I'm adding the engineer slash programmer, this is the how you solve this is with a crisis. This crisis is solved with a revolution. A revolution, so it's like a major change. So now let's bring it back to us. Right now, all these general purpose programming languages are adding functional features. So I propose that right now we're in a functional programming revolution because it's literally everywhere. And I think like none of you are surprised. None of you are going like, you're obviously crazy. And also we're in a Scala programming conference, so yeah, I guess that's, but functional programming has existed since 1956. Well, actually, way before. But as an actual programming language, IPL implemented some first functional features, stuff. This is 1956. It's like, some grannies and grandparents are that age. Because the moment as a person, so let's reconcile this. The moment as a person you decide that thing that you believed in before is not the thing that it's like that's just not working for you anymore because it doesn't make sense for you. You have no choice but to flip. You have to flip, you have to switch sides. And I'm doing air quotes because it's like you go to the dark side or to the light side. So that's really interesting. So this is interesting because we're here right now talking about this. This is so meta, I love it. So it's like we're actually trying to philosophize on this because we actually need to think about it. So, and this is what explains, I think, two scientists in school disagree about what a problem and what a solution actually is. Now, I don't know you, but I feel very identified with that. Talking past each other. So, when we're saying this is incommensurable, what are we talking about? We're saying, when you tell me how great your paradigm is, you're just talking about this thing, about this particular time, and I'm talking about chairs. Just we're not talking about the same thing. So, all this has happened before. He was talking about the history of science, and I can feel like so identified with this that it's ridiculous, right? Since we're going to be changing stuff so long, so all the time, should we, like, instead of fighting about it, start to maybe learn how to get better at it? You know? So, as programmers, we need to, like, do all this stuff. It's you cut corners, we fight, we complain about these languages and everything. But in the end, the same way Alonso Church and Turing, we unify in this thing, which is programming, right? So no matter how much we fight, it's like, it's going to be programming in the end. We need to get better at, so we identify the problem. The problem is that these things are changing. So solution, let's get better by changing. It's like, if it hurts, automate it, right? So, trust me, there's not much more papers. So this is good. So the first mention of programming paradigms is from this ACM Turing Award lecture by Floyd in 1978. He wrote this paper inspired by Thomas Kuhn's Structure of Scientific Revolution. And he asked in this, basically the short version of that, I think, is he said, I am familiar with a bunch of paradigms / concepts. If you're creating a new language and you don't give me this stuff, I don't like it. Do I agree with that? Well, as someone that loves programming languages quite a bit, I'm like, hey, just go crazy and give me all the crazy you want. But as someone that needs to ship stuff, I kind of agree with that because you work with a bunch of people and not everybody's crazy, or at least not crazy like I am. They have a different crazy. This is really good. And this goes with what Kali was saying in the panel as well. It's like, when you're teaching something, find the stuff that works for you and show the patterns to the students so they can learn it and get, you know, fake it till you make it. Good. And this is something that I think maybe because we're here in this conference, like we're turning up to a conference on a Saturday morning. I'm pretty sure we're doing this anyway. But this stuff needs to go everywhere. People need to learn stuff every day and get better at whatever they do. So, we're herding the cats now. So there is some cats pictures. But I think this is the upcoming one. So people are part of the concepts. When you're getting ready to like go fight, think about what they are thinking. You don't need to, when you're trying to make a point, if you don't know where people are coming from, you're never going to convince them of anything. Try to think about what is it that they see that maybe you're not seeing. Write about it. Write a blog post about why you think something is actually good. So, I give you a challenge. Who's doing 6502 compiling, like assembly code? Yay! So, if you haven't done it, go try it out. You know what? It's really, there's very, very, it's completely different. I haven't done it before. So for me, it's like mind-blowingly changing on how you think about solutions. Who's done logic programming, some problem? Okay, the rest of you, try it out. And this is not you haven't done it, pitchfork. This is about, if you have this in your brain, then this is like, you used to have just a hammer, and now I gave you a screwdriver and maybe a saw and different tools for any kind of things. And so learn stuff. So unsurprisingly, the party is programming, and everybody's invited. So this party about the paradigms actually was about programming, you know? So this is kind of the end of my talk. I really hope you have, like, you want to tell me how I'm wrong, because if we all agree, we're not going to change things, or maybe we will. But this is what I wanted to tell you. I hope that you enjoyed it, and thank you very much. Okay, so any questions?
So thanks for the talk. How do I choose the next paradigm to learn?
Well, I generally, so chaos is a beautiful thing. So choose at random. No, I mean, it's like everything. For example, for me, I know the way I learn, and that's some way. Like, it's my way. So just choose what are you doing? Do you like making games? Well, then do a game with some or weird programming language. But think about the paradigms. If you go from something like C# and you go and choose Java, I mean, you're gonna learn some stuff, but is it really changing the way you think? If it's not changing the way you think, then maybe you should do something else. If you kind of want a sampler, there's two books called, there's version 1 and 2 of 7 Languages in 7 Weeks. Have you ever heard of it? Okay, well, you should. This basically goes through 7 different languages that apply 7 different paradigms, and so you get a sampler, and you go like that. Actually, that book made a big impact in my life because it showed me stuff that I was like, what? There's more than a couple of paradigms? There's what? And there's 2 versions of that. There's a new one. So that might work.
Wait a second.
Or was it?
What's the next paradigm that you have on your radar that could like change your life as a programmer? Is it like dependent types, or what's the next thing you think is going to be big?
Oh, big! But see, that's the thing. You know, when I'm talking about me, and this is why I like our representatives, I'm kind of weird. And so, for example, right now I'm trying to learn more metaprogramming. And assembler at the same time, because why not? But I think if I'm kind of looking at trends and what the world is doing, I don't think it's crazy to think that something like constraint programming logic / dependent types, it could be a thing. Like, people are definitely interested in this stuff and they want to learn. So if you want to go with that, I think people should choose what they want, because if that way you are interested, you're vested, you're like, what is this weird thing? And it calls me. You know, if you watch Disney movies, the water calls you, Moana. Anyway, I'll shut up now. There's a whole song about it. Look at me breaking the song. Yeah.
So why do you think that people are very defensive towards their de facto language? And what could you do to open their minds? So, like, in my experience, I had to deal with people that were like very religious about Ruby, for example, or seriously, or JavaScript and so on. But they would be never open-minded to experiment something new.
Okay.
So, like, for them, the hammer would solve every problem they had.
Of course, yeah, and this is a very human trait. So when someone attacks so when we're discussing, it's not something we do as humans. Basically, the default way to deal with some, I tell you, you know, something. Let's focus on you because you're in front of me. Unlucky. So if I tell you, even now, he's probably defensive already. If I tell you, I don't like your shoe, that particular shoe, literally the worst. I don't mind shoe. I think you tied it wrong. And you could tie it in this more efficient way in which he will never untie. Which is maybe, I found that really useful. Maybe he doesn't care. The natural reaction is to defend. So you will never ever unless people are used to discussing stuff without going to fights, you will never change their minds on discussion. So they need to change themselves. It's not your job to change them. Your job is to change you.
But I mean, the question is like, you wouldn't go judging or attacking. It was mostly about exploring, right? Just like, try some new concepts.
Well, my version, my response to that is doing this talk, because I'm hoping that more people realize, like, some people didn't know there was more paradigms. And it's like, it's good. That is, like, I am so happy that someone learned something today, and that they are like, it's amazing. You know, because the moment you discover that, it's beautiful. And if I can do that for one person, I'm like, totally nailed this job, you know? So you need to, I've tried to focus on people that, you know, I know some stuff that maybe they don't know, and then you kind of go, whoever is not willing to, at some point, that person that loves Ruby and is totally Rubying the shit out of everything, is gonna realize that, because they're gonna learn so much, and at some point you run out of room, because you learn so much Ruby, and then you kind of go like, right, I need to do this thing that Ruby doesn't want to do well, or I see that our solution, and you know, you realize it's better, or maybe not, but that's their journey. So my version of this is just trying to say, hey, look at all this other stuff, and this is how we can think about it, and I know, again, try to show, you know, kind of sideways. You kind of need to show them a mirror and that they realize it's them. That's, I don't know. I don't think you can solve this in a talk, really.
So if I was to ask a company, you know, or if I was to ask a company, what programming language you think you should use? What is the safest bet? I feel like they might say something like Java, I don't know, Python. But what I hear from you is that maybe the safest choice is a multi-paradigm language, one that scales over time and people. What are your thoughts there?
I think the answer I'm trying to give is context is completely key. It's like I'm doing a miles here. I'm like, it depends. And the context is really key, because what is the group of people you have? There is no silver bullet. There's no safest. Believing that is, you know, it's really nice, but it's also, you know, not true. You have to say, if I have to work with Miles and John, there is a context. If I have to work with Ooh, who loves performance, there is a completely different context. Not because.
But
she only cares about performance. So it's like. You will, you know, you need to actually read the people. And I think that's work. I think also, if you scale to like many people, that's crazy. That's just not gonna work. Because the more people you get, the more context you get. The moment you lost engagement with people, you know, it's like, it might work, but it's just way harder. So maybe it's a combo of modularizing the problem enough that you can have smaller groups of people, and then maybe you can reach agreement within those and have very, very good constraints. So you're going back to John Hughes on modularizing stuff. So does the language and or technologies you're using, does it give you good tools for modularization? So I guess that's maybe part of the answer.
Thanks so much.
You're welcome. By the way, I love the questions. I'm loving the questions.
We have time for more questions, though.
Hi. Thank you for the talk. Is it about competing paradigms? Because I sometimes see that imperative programming and functional programming are not necessarily should not necessarily be seen as competing. Because in some way you can see monadic programming as imperative programming. So in my experience, what we have seen is that sometimes it is not about conflicting paradigms, but about the techniques that you use to do imperative programming using Java, for instance, and the techniques that you can use in Scala to do imperative programming at a higher level of abstraction. So I tend to think that functional programming is superior to to functional, to imperative programming, in the sense that it is more declarative, it is more general, it's more encompassing. And your view is that okay, this is these are. I think I want you to correct me. Your view is that okay, there are many existing paradigms, all kind, all of them can coexist. It might. I tend to be more sort of Taliban. Sorry. I think that functional programming should be. So I had problems with people like who.
Yeah, but that's actually.
So I would like you how can we say these things to who in a more soft way.
Well, the things like you're basically saying. So my talk actually is trying to show that who thinks what. So I was thinking my talk is at an abstract level. This is kind of you, like in the future, right? Bacon is you in the future, because like after a while, Bacon becomes like, as you called yourself, a Taliban of functional programming. who wants to learn functional programming? Mostly because they're using this language, but actually, when I then Odersky thinks that multi paradigms, Odersky, Donsheim, and Peter Van Roy think that multi paradigm programming languages and approaches are the right way to go. So my opinion is doesn't matter, because what I'm trying to show you is all these different opinions, and the things like you're asking me, how do we help this poor imperative person in their wrong ways, and the things like, you know, I relate to that, I can see it, I feel frustration sometimes when dealing with that. At the same time, I don't know that if you're doing embedded programming, is functional programming really the right approach? I don't know. I kind of think that these are tools, like the paradigms are tools for thinking. So the same as programming languages. So if you're convinced that this is your solution to most problems, I'm totally fine with that. But the thing is, you can't coerce people. They need to make the change. It's the same question that he asked in a way. It's like, this Ruby person is crazy, and they just want to use Ruby for everything. Which is, when you say it like that, it even sounds crazy, because everyone knows that you can't use Ruby for everything. I mean, you can. Do you want to? So anything to the max generally is a problem, but it's also a very natural response. So that's what Kuhn is telling us. Kuhn is telling us, you flip. Because it's your core beliefs as a person. We're all irrational beings. We kind of like to think that we're somewhat logical, and that's great. But we need to believe in what we do. We all are here because we believe in what we do. So you believe FP is the solution. And I think it's great, because you truly believe it, and you're very, I have a nice logical approach to it. And when I talk to you, give me a solution for this, you actually thought about it, and you come up with really good solutions. So that's your core. Eventually, like we weren't born this way. You know, when you were three, you thought that probably chocolate was the best thing ever. I don't know. You know, it's like, but your core sense of belief tends to evolve with time. So, you know, you need to let people convince themselves. You need to give them a mirror. That's the best I can come up with anyway. Yeah.
Okay, so maybe not a question, but a comment. So the reason people get defensive when somebody criticizes, let's say, Ruby, is because after a while, when you invest a lot of time in a language, it becomes kind of part of your identity. So when you criticize a language, it's a human thing to accept this as an attack on the self.
Yes.
And if you want to read more about it, there's a great comic by The Oatmeal.
Oh yeah.
Who likes The Oatmeal? On the backfire effect. So read on the backfire effect.
Yeah. Yeah, that's totally, that's plus one on that.
Any more questions?
I mean, I'm between you and coffee, like. I'm aware of that, Frank. Frank.
Well, in that case, let's thank the speaker.